Augustus called that night after dinner. I was already in bed. After dinner had become my bedtime for the moment, propped up with a gajillion pillows and also brewing, with my computer on my lap. I picked up saying, "Bad news," and he said, "Shit, what? I can't go to Amsterdam. One of my doctors thinks it's a bad idea." He was quiet for a second. "God," he said, "I should've just paid for it myself. Should've just taken you straight from the funky bones to Amsterdam. But then I would've had a probably fatal episode of deoxygenation in Amsterdam, and my body would have been shipped home in the cargo hold of an airplane." I said, "Well, yeah," he said. But before that, my grand romantic gesture would have totally gotten me late. I left pretty hard. Hard enough that I fell where the chest tube had been. "You left because it's true," he said. I left again. "It's true, isn't it?" "Probably not," I said. And then after a moment added, "Although you never know." He moaned in misery. "I'm gonna die a virgin," he said. "You're a virgin?" I asked, surprised. "Hazel Grace," he said. "Do you have a pen and a piece of paper?" I said I did. "Okay, please draw a circle." I did. "Now draw a smaller circle within that circle." I did. "The larger circle is virgins. The smaller circle is 17-year-old guys with one leg." I left again and told him that having most of your social engagements occur at the children's hospital also did not encourage promiscuity. And then we talked about Peter Van Houten's amazingly brilliant comment about the sluttiness of time. And even though I was in bed and he was in his basement, it really felt like we were back in that uncreated third space, which was a place I really liked visiting with him. Then I got off the phone and my mom and dad came into my room. And even though it was really not big enough for all three of us, they lay on either side of the bed with me and we all watched the ANTM on the little TV in my room. This girl I didn't like, Selena, got kicked off, which made me really happy for some reason. Then mom hooked me up to the bipap and tucked me in. And dad kissed me on the forehead. The kiss all stubble. And then I closed my eyes. The bipap essentially took control of my breathing away from me, which was intensely annoying. But the great thing about it was that it made all this noise, rumbling with itchy inhalation and whirring as I exhaled. I kept thinking that it sounded like a dragon breathing in time with me, like I had this pet dragon who was cuddled up next to me and cared enough about me to time his breath to mine. I was thinking about that. I sank into sleep. I got up late the next morning. I watched TV in bed and checked my email. And then after a while, started crafting an email to Peter Van Houten about how I couldn't come to Amsterdam, but I swore upon the life of my mother that I would never share any information about the characters with anyone, that I didn't even want to share it, because I was a terribly selfish person. And could he please just tell me if the Dutch Killer Man is for real, and if Anna's mom marries him, and also about Sisyphus the hamster. But I didn't send it. It was too pathetic, even for me. Around three, when I figured Augustus would be home from school, I went into the backyard and called him. As the phone rang, I sat down on the grass, which was all overgrown and dandelion. That Sphinx said was still back there, weeds growing out of the little ditch I'd created from kicking myself higher as a little kid. I remember Dad bringing home the kit from Toys R Us, and bedding it in the backyard with a neighbor. He'd insisted on swinging on it first to test it, and the thing damn near broke. The sky was gray and low and full of rain, but not yet rainy. I hung up when I got Augustus's voicemail, and then put the phone down in the dirt beside me and kept looking at the swing set, thinking that I'd give up all the sick days I had left for a few healthy ones. I tried to tell myself that it could be worse, that the world was not a wish-granting factory, that I was living with cancer, not dying of it, that I mustn't let it kill me before it kills me. And then I just started muttering stupid over and over again until the sound unhinged from its meaning. I was still saying it when he called back. "Hi," I said. "Hazel Grace," he said. "Hi," I said again. "Are you crying, Hazel Grace?" "Kind of." "Why?" he asked. "'Cause I want to go to Amsterdam, and I want him to tell me what happens after the book is over, and I just don't want my particular life. And also the sky is depressing me, and there is this old swing set out here that my dad made for me when I was a kid. I must see this old swing set appears immediately," he said. "I'll be over in 20 minutes."